So I'm happy to run a monitor in the projector. I haven't done a lot of prep work, but I was thinking of picking up where we left off. I don't know how many people were here. How many people were here for the previous GBP Skillshare bot? And how many people were not here for the previous GBP Skillshare bot? Okay, cool, great. So it's a mix. So come on in and sit down. I need to stand in the doorway. Probably we'll cover some of the same territory that we covered in the previous one, but probably people will also have other things to share because there are new people too. So the basic idea is just to try to spend the 45 minutes that we have to talk about our GBP workflows. One possibility is to pick a package and I could drive a console or something if people wanted to tell me what to do, and we could look at packaging one. That was something that we didn't do at the previous Skillshare. People could call out and tell me what to do. I won't do anything that you tell me, but I will do things that look reasonable. If we wanted to take as an example, like packaging new hello or whatever, to show how it works. We can also run through some of the highlights of last time. What are people interested in? What would people think would be useful?
What about something that's already in Git, like using like non-standard tags and doing all this stuff?
Where the packaging is already in Git?
The upstream is in Git, right?
Okay.
But does not use the official tag mechanism that you just made. So how do we, then we have to make a clone and we have to do the tags.
Let me ask another question first. Who here currently uses Git for their Debian packaging, with Git build package or not?
Without.
So I think that's everyone, Mac. Oh, no, not everyone. Okay. And who here does not currently use Git build package for the packages? Okay. So I'm assuming that the folks are using the video team. You guys might not care about Git build package, but I'm assuming the folks who are here for the meeting are here because they're interested in learning how to use Git build package. And so in some sense, I think starting with a thing that has the most complicated corner cases is not the way to go for those folks. But maybe, but there aren't that many. I don't know. I don't want to run people away if they're not used to the base case. Yeah, I'm not sure what the right next steps are. Do you have a package in particular, for example, that you want to look at?
I have a few, but they're way too big for this.
Well, I think the problem you're referring to is that upstream doesn't maintain proper tagging on upstream releases. Like, for example, I have a package where they tag it with dates instead of versions, so all the automatic stuff doesn't work. Like, they release a version 0.9.0 and they name it, the tag is not called 0.9.0 but 2015 05 05 or something, like some date, and I need to maintain a separate tagging to translate those dates into some version in order to at least use some kind of automatism, and that's what I'm doing. But I don't know if that is the best approach, but hard coding it every time you invoke Git build package is also...
Well, you're only hard coding it every time you invoke Git GBP import ridge, right? In which case,
yeah.
You have to have looked at upstream... I mean, as a packager, I try to look at upstream's code. I don't, deeply sleep over every single commit, but I do try to look at upstream's code, so I have to know something before I'm doing an import ridge.
Yeah.
And so then the easiest thing for me to do is to know what the names of the most recent tags are.
Yeah.
So in terms of automatizing that, I'm not sure.
No, well, but on subsequent releases, I mean, the problem will occur on every release.
Yeah, so every importer ridge, I say, oh yeah, and the upstream VCS tag for this one is, fuzzy purple unicorn, or
yeah,
whatever
exactly.
They chose. But then that's just, you just apply an extra argument for getting importer ridge each time.
I'm not automating it. I'm just creating an own tag in order also for me to have as a reference for future use. I will forget about this, and then I would have to look in Debian changelog or someone which upstream version, or in the Git history, which version it corresponds to. If I maintain my own additional tags that have same naming conventions, then I always have this at my hand for the whole history of the package.
Right, that makes sense.
And if I supply it only on each import, then the information is lost after the import, or not lost, but deeply hidden in some way.
Have you shown those tags to upstream?
No.
Why not?
Well, they don't. They don't really have. Well, I could do that.
I think you should. I've actually had an experience where upstream was using an underscore in their tags, like foo underscore version number, and the version number replaced all the dots with underscores as well. And I looked at it and I was like, why are you doing? Like, this is a pain in my ass to figure out what the right tag is. And I went and did a little, revision control archaeology to figure out why they might have done it. And it was because they had converted from CVS. And CVS didn't let you put dots in your tags because then they would look like a version number.
Okay.
And so I just wrote upstream and I was like, I think you're doing this because that was the CVS convention. And it would be much more, it would be much easier for me as your downstream packager if you just put it in this other convention. And here's a couple of git commands you can do for the new version. Now, if you've just released a new version, it's got the underscores, could you do this command, and that would make another tag on it, and then for future things, maybe you could think about switching it to the new one.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh yeah, sure, no problem.
I guess it makes sense to talk to upstream in this case, because it also seems they can't decide between the date version and the real version.
Yeah, sometimes all they need is just a push from somebody who says, hey, it matters to me, and if it doesn't matter to you guys, just do it the way that matters to me. That's one of the things that I definitely recommend we can actually help fix the broader ecosystem in that way by saying, at Debian, we like same packaging practices.
Which actually reminds me of a completely different thing, which is that we seem to have this tradition in Debian that we make this wiki page with a how-to, and it only covers strictly the absolutely politically correct case. And then there's no help. Right. And then we have this kind of session where all sorts of things are flying around, but we're not recording it anywhere in any way that's actually helpful.
LBR?
Well, right. That's not nearly as easy to access,
sure,
to find as a how-to or something. Am I making sense a little bit here, right? There's so many special things that you would have liked to have notes in, by the way, in the wiki, and then there are three tutorials that we particularly on Git build package, and they're just slightly different, not really compatible. So if you follow one and then try to follow another one later, it just breaks.
Mm.
So I don't know if that's worthwhile. I mean, that would be a worthwhile time.
Yeah.
We did that in the Haskell group in the dev camp, right? One person just spent the whole dev camp, me really, right? Just rewriting the tutorial so that there was just one which covered several cases and made notes.
I guess it depends on who's reading the tutorial. I sometimes find that if I'm reading a tutorial that's huge, then I'm just like, whoa, don't have the time to take all this in. So maybe you've got good ways of writing a tutorial that allow those special cases to be broken off and skipped over by people who aren't encountering them. Otherwise, it's just, wall of text, eyes glaze over, overload scenario.
But in general, I think that this is a valid point. If there are some exceptions, often you need a bit more digging.
Yeah, for sure.
But another point is, anyone in the room who started with Git build package and he was quite new to Debian, packaging at all, and then most of the tutorials are geared towards migrating of like no version control at all or from SVN build package or so on. So the case where you start from scratch is not covered in a lot of tutorials. There's a huge focus on converting existing packages to Git build package. That's just my observation, and I think this would be something that could be improved.
I just wanted to say, it sounds like what you're saying is that the great thing about tutorials is that there's so many to choose from.
No, but I think I totally agree with him. It's really confusing because you follow one tutorial and then you realize, oh wait, it doesn't cover this little bit that I need. And then you go to the other tutorial, oh, it has that bit, and then it doesn't work because it's not... Like, the workflows are different, and then so they're not always easily combinable. And I think that's the problem you're addressing.
Yes, and the tutorials don't say when it's sort of the developer's personal preference and when it's something you have to do it that way.
Yeah.
And I have some kind of same problem. I have a package that evolved very slowly. So every time I have to read the documentation because I forget how it works, and if I don't take the same one, it doesn't work. And I forget.
So are we, I mean, as a community of users of Git build package, are we saying that we want there to be one canonical workflow? So that you're...
No.
I'm seeing violent yeses and violent noes. So, I mean, again, we have this these two rows of seats. We can arrange it.
Beyond what we want, I'm not even sure that's really possible. Is it? To have one unified workflow?
For Git build package? For Debian packaging, sure, that's out of the question, right? I mean, Debian packagers know. But, I mean, we have the Git build package developer who can say, I'm just not going to bother with this particular workflow, and if you want to do that, go use something else. And, I mean, in some ways, I don't know what your take on it is. But
yes, basically, as long as I think there are several things, like, you don't want to support every workflow, basically, and I think there is one workflow which is like in the tutorials and on the pages, which is kind of like the workflow I think most people are using. And if there's something else, like for example, you don't want to store the upstream tuple in Git, but you want to have it separate, and it's reasonable to support with an endless amount of code and not being like in every place, then I think that's perfectly fine, and everything else should, I guess, discuss in the main, so the bug reports or something like that. So if it doesn't work the way you think, then it can be a bug, or it can be like missing documentation, or maybe it just can't do what you want. So, and if it can't do what you want, it might be out of scope for the tool because it's just a layer above or below, because it can't drive Bazaar but only Git, for example. Or it might be just something where you want to kick off like 10 Jenkins slaves which build all the packages, which would probably be the layer above that. So that's an area where I think the build package should do its job, and where it doesn't, we should fix it. And maybe it's not very clear where the boundary is at the moment.
Exactly the last thing, right? So if the tag must be named v1.0.
No, it doesn't.
One tutorial reads like that.
Okay, yeah.
And you don't know whether that's a limitation of Git build package or not. So it would be nice just at the start, just like the tech book, you know, Dangerous Sharp Bend or whatever, saying, here, you can have other choices, other people wrote about it over there.
Yeah.
That's all. Right. That's really, really helpful. Whereas if there is something which is really fundamental, I don't mind that the tar files are stored where you say it. And if that's a choice you made, well, then say so. You really make sure you do this, because otherwise Git package is not going to work for you nicely. Yeah, it's really good, but I mean, be happy to help. It's just a matter of getting it done.
I mean, in some sense, the idea of supporting extra workflows is not just about whether it's more code for you to maintain, but it's also about for other people who are writing documentation and tutorials and whatnot. Like, oh, now they have to think about this other case.
Sure.
So in some sense, it's more useful to the community, I think, to say fewer workflows.
Yeah, I think that, but they should be comfortable.
Yeah.
By the way, a question. Where does GBPDCH know the upstream version? Sometimes it guesses correctly.
Well, it should actually, like the version past Jesse has some improvements on that one. So it basically kind of looks for the last merge from the upstream branch and goes there.
Where does this information come from? From upstream tags?
Yeah, exactly.
So actually, it matters what the actual upstream tag name is.
So it matters that there's basically the same number in there you want for your Debian package, but it doesn't matter if it's V version or it's upstream slash version. You have some variants in that. You just have to tell Git build package like what the format is.
What it's
like.
I did not. But maybe it's recognized.
Yeah, so it has the default layout where it's just like Debian, like it says upstream slash version number, and that's the default. But you can, if you want to have like a format which is a V version number, then you can specify that and you can use that one to detect it.
I think it's not documented, at least I didn't find it in the GBPDCH.
At least there's like the upstream version option documented, and this one.
Maybe, yes, you can specify it.
And I read those, and there's one which says you should add tags upstream slash version. which if you do it yourself, of course, it works.
It could have come from the upstream.
But I don't know how upstream would put versions with upstream in it.
No, it's basically so that basically depends on so if you use GPP import orig for importing the original tarball, it will just do everything for you because it and so the tool is like if you put all these information in the default section, then it's right for all tools. So if GPP import orig puts the tag, GPP DCH will obviously be able to read it. But in some cases where upstream uses Git, then you obviously have to tell the tool like how it is what it's named.
That automatic detection did not work for me. I always have to figure out, wait, where did I merge last, and then tell it manually.
Yeah. So if that is the case, then just publish your repository and kind of like show how to invoke it, and then we can have a look.
Okay.
So
yeah, but it's that kind of remark which is helpful in the tutorial, right? It'll say, do orita, import orita, right?
Yes.
It'll say, now it knows your version number. Well,
okay. Yeah.
Start. If it actually doesn't know your version number, here's some text that tells you what you would do.
So these are the configs that you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then there's also a Git. So what I'm looking at is this file here. So this is the default Git build package config, and it could also live in. Actually, it has a manual page. It's quite nice. It shows you the different places you can put it and the order in which it will look. So I personally like to use this. And I don't muck around with this because I don't want to have to sync it across, you know, different buildies that I'm working on. And this I don't particularly like because it affects all of the package builds that I do from a single user account. And if I build from another user account, it doesn't work.
Yeah, but it's useful for putting key IDs there, for example. So
yes.
That's the main purpose, I think.
And this is per Git repository. And this is per package to be published. And this is... and this one we're deprecating, right?
Yeah.
So all of these things matter, and they go in this order, right?
Yeah.
So
the last wins.
No, first wins.
Really?
Yeah, this configuration in this overrides configuration in this.
So last wins.
So
it depends on the direction of the arrow.
Yeah.
Lowest wins.
Yeah.
So maybe the last one should be promoted before the Debian specific. The Debian.
You think this should win over this?
Probably.
Don't
because that's.
Oof. Making a change. I mean, I don't know what's right, but making a change in this once people are already using it is.
Yeah.
Complicated. Although this is the room to make the change in it, right?
So if the other one would win, you would never have a chance to override something that comes back badly from Aliot, for example.
Okay.
So that's why you have that one. So if the Aliot configuration is somehow broken and you want like override something, then you can put it in your repository. And if you swap it around, then the remote configuration would always override this.
Okay.
So I have a question. We started a brand new picture repository, and I was wondering if we are doing that right. Because upstream does tagging, it's perfectly fine. They even sign tags, but they also provide tarballs on the GitHub page, and we have set up something like we track the upstream repository, but use GBG to import that, set that the upstream tags, but still import the upstream tarball, which was something I read in some manual. That's laying around. So is this the right way, or could we simply not use the upstream tarball because we have tags?
I think there are two schools of thoughts here. So one is like importing the upstream tarball and using the upstream DCS tag option to kind of link the upstream history to your tarball. So if upstream is halfway sane, I then skip the tarballs entirely because I have like the whole history. Why would I bother importing another piece which I don't know about? And if I keep the upstream history in Git anyway, I would just use that one, generate the tarball. Rather, the only reason is basically that if upstream, for example, signs its tarballs but doesn't sign its tags, then you have like a better trust chain if you use the tarball and import that one.
In my case, the upstream tarballs contain generated files which define the version from the software. So
the make this step is the difference there, right?
So even though I don't need these autoconf stuff, I still need the retar bar because it does contain really specific stuff.
Yeah, I think that's fine and supported. So that's what I meant when I say upstream is halfway sane. So usually I should be able to regenerate that thing with the make.
Yes, it is perfectly sane. So it's a great upstream if it does the release right. Sometimes it does not, and you just have to get the toggle from the git.
Yeah.
The auto generated toggles, which are worthless because they are exact. They have the exact same content that the git repository does, and these can be available because they miss this version information, dot version, dot toggle version, and whatever.
So I see a couple of differences here. One of them is that, so I'm trying to encourage everyone to check their upstream signatures, right? And if an upstream signs their git tags and signs their tarballs, we can actually ship the signature for their tarball in Debian.
DAC, as long as you don't have to filter or something.
As long as you don't have to filter, right? And DAC is now supporting that. And so that means that we can actually get upstream signatures more widely distributed and other people can verify upstream signatures. Whereas we can't do that with the git tag, assigned git tag, because that would imply that we're willing to redistribute the entire git history, which may contain all kinds of non-DFSC stuff. And the other thing is, so one of the things that's different about make dist from git archive format tar is auto tools, right? So upstream has a set of auto tools that they're using to do their thing. They generate a tarball with make dist, and it puts in the image of the auto tools generated files that they have. So are you doing auto reconf or using auto tools dev? I mean, do people think that's the current best practice within Debian to do auto reconf in those cases? I'm seeing nodding mostly.
I had a real problem with that in that if upstream has a configure and an AC local, which is broken, and I have to regenerate, then the DH also reconfigure clean thing to do the right thing. I can't find a way to get DH also reconfigure clean, which is the target that's supposed to take them away to do the right thing. They keep coming back and not going away. In principle, when I do make clean,
if your upstream ships the file in your in upstream tarball,
yes,
and you remove it, and you're using debug source v1, it comes back because it is in your merged tarball and diff cannot say debug source is moving the files.
But if you're not stable, it can. You can say remove files and it will allow you to do a patch that removes files, except it's not really working. It's the same kind of thing. But it's not Git builder.
But there's stuff besides the auto. I mean, I actually do think that auto reconf tends to be the right thing to do because Debian has a set of auto tools and we would like to not depend on a bunch of. The auto tools generated files are huge chunks of code that aren't really the preferred form for modification or anything. And so, like, relying on the pieces that are in Debian is probably better. But then there are these other things of like generating header files that upstream is doing manually somehow as part of the release process that's different from auto tools. And I don't know how to get to those. So I think those are good reasons to do the tarball.
if you're importing a tarball and it fails for whatever reason, how do you actually recover? Go you to the upstream and percentile branches and reset history manually, or what?
That's what I do, it's ugly.
Yeah, I'm wondering, because as soon as it fails, you have to do more manual work and redo or untry or retry until it's working, or don't you care and just push the first entire upstream branches like several upstream commits?
So the next or maybe the over next version will clean up for you.
Nice.
Already started. Not saying which version that exactly is, but it has some. So I have a version.
When it's ready.
Yeah. With some rollback support.
Thanks.
But I do clean up manually.
Mm-hmm. So does anyone have any non-manual cleanup approach? Snapshotting .git before. I don't know.
it's also sort of manual, right? It's just a different kind
of... Yeah, but it's a one-step manual. Instead of being like, now I got to switch over to this branch and fiddle with that thing. It seems like it could work.
Yeah.
How are you going to do robots for it?
Sorry? Yes, I just remember the old Shaw ones that are there. And then just if something fails, you just reset the heads.
Okay.
So, and there are some slight things because it might create branches, so you don't roll back the SHA-1, but you have to remove the branch and all these kind of things. First off, you try to like create most of the tough stuff outside of what the user sees and then move it in.
So, another question regarding our repository, we need to remove files from the upstream tower that we're currently using. Is this a reason to use the tarball, or can we somehow remove the single Windows binary
so I think
that
the,
we do not need using just the git tags?
So I think the safest way is like using gscan already.
Yeah.
I think it's upper on the list already. So gscan can read the deb5 headers in the copyrights file and remove them.
You can
regardless
files.
Regardless, we're using the tarball or using...
No, only when you use... When you use uscan to import the tarball, it will just unpack it.
Yeah, you're already doing that.
Right.
So if you want to get rid of the upstream tarball...
So I'm in the lucky situation that all my upstreams are as sane at the moment that I don't have to have. But I know people...
So do you know about the headers in...
Yeah, we're using that.
Okay.
But I was thinking about not importing the upstream tower, but since our upstream assigns its tags, simply rely on the tags.
And so then you would do a filter output, like an archive with a filter on the archive to generate the tarball?
I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
If you're generating a tarball from Git, it's usually done with Git archive.
Yeah.
Right? So you say Git archive tree-ish.
So, yeah.
But then you could also say filter and say, I don't want these pieces.
Okay.
But, yeah, given that there's other mechanism to use it with the tarball, I would use the tarball with the user mechanism.
By the way, is it okay to keep those non-distributable files in the area of repository?
This came up at the previous discussion. And it sounds to me like there's no limit in terms of what you can keep on ADIA other than the DMVP. And I don't think that the Debian machine usage policy, I don't think that it has a constraint about that. So I think, yeah, go ahead and keep that in ADIA. And if we find that that is a problem, then people will have to make changes, but I would go ahead and use ADIA to benefit your Debian packaging, which means keeping track of upstream's commits. What's that?
That's a good thing.
Yeah, I think there's all kinds of things that need to come off of ADIA if we're not allowed. I mean, if there's stuff that's in there that's like going to get Debian in legal trouble, you know, like Metallica or child pornography or, you know, something even worse than Metallica, then don't do it. Does anyone have any other specific GBP-related workflow problems that they've had recently?
Yeah, actually, we're using the patch queue thing, and we used to move our dev8 patches for the auto build in the daemon patches report directory into our subdirectory dev8. And every time you do a GPG export, those are deleted.
Can you describe the scenario again?
It sounds more like a bug, but that shouldn't actually happen, so...
At least. Probably I have an audit version.
Yeah. Because the dev8 specific patches are not part of the patch series.
Okay, so they are separate.
Yeah.
Okay.
We want to, we keep them in the patch queue branch, patch queue master branch. But when you do an export for the first time, you have to git am the Debian patches dev8 stuff, and then manually remove them from the patch series.
Yeah, So, but what's the purpose of keeping them in the package and not having them in the series file?
We want to be able to revise the patches.
So, okay, so let me see if I can get this right. I'm still not sure I understand the scenario. So you're using git build package with patch queue, but you also want your patches, the ones that are in Debian patches, to have the dep8 headers.
Some of them we have a sub folder.
Dep8 is for the auto package test CI.
Dep5 is the copyright. There are headers for the files for the patches. Sorry, you got your hand up for a while.
For the subdirectories, there's a gbppq test you can attach to those patches. That's a gbppq topic, and then they will, when exported, be put in the separate directory, so you don't have to move them around again.
Yes, but we don't want them to be applied when we build the package. We only want to apply them when we run the auto package CI to the CI stuff.
Okay.
I have an interesting issue. So take the same use case where upstream develops in Git, and everything is included in Git, so you don't have to deal with parboils or anything. So you have a pure Git workflow. So you configure your repository locally to have a upstream remote and pull in, so the upstream has a new version you want to update with the Debian package to. So you do some stuff locally. How do I communicate the fact that the upstream repository is at this other remote URL and has a particular layout? Because right now what I do is I essentially just write in the Debian readme.source file how to configure this, how to update the to a new version. Is there any way to automate that, that setup for, collaborator, co-maintainers?
Not within git build package, so, because usually when upstream uses git and it tags, then you actually don't have to do much more than a git fetch, because it pulls in all the tags and that's all it needs, and then
But your new contributor doesn't know about upstream repository.
Yeah, sure, I understand that, but basically that's an area we currently don't cover at the moment at all, so.
Would it be useful to put something in debian.gbp.conf that says upstream's repository is over here, and then you can have tooling that could make use of that?
So, if that helps, so maybe then gbp pool could pull from the remote as well, or something like that? So
the VCS, TS, or in the header, in Debian control file, couldn't be reused for that?
The VCS get in Debian control file refers to the packaging
here,
not to upstream. Right? And so if our goal here is to merge upstream's history with the Debian packaging, then your co-maintainers want both. So
you could probably use the source header in Debian copyright?
Well, really? The header in Debian copyright usually points towards like a URL that explains what the project is.
Right. So it could point to the source code, right? It could point to the Git repository.
It could, but other people might be using that too. I definitely don't want to change that right now for some of my headers, because they point to a description of the project, which is actually useful.
Yeah, I would say this is actually a missing field in a sense. I mean, it's sometimes scary that you get a package, if you just get it with that, get source or whatever, and there's really no clue as to where the actual source of that package came from. It's hidden in how, so putting it in readme.source is nice. That's actually a service, but many packages don't have anything in readme.source.
But a formalized place where we know to look for it would be even better. Right?
Exactly. So a field somewhere would be actually very nice.
Could this be part of Debian control to make it not specific for Git?
That'd be really nice.
That would be really nice.
So who do we need to file a bug against?
Package.
Let's get the tooling in place, and once the tooling's in place, then we can add the policy that you have to use it. If we put the policy in place, then we have to use the tooling, and we don't have the tooling, then...
But it's like upstream VCS or something, VCS upstream, really.
Yeah.
So there's a DEP 12 proposal which proposes a new file in the source packages Debian upstream metadata. So maybe we
I've seen that. It's used by IkiWiki.
Okay. So it might be good idea to not invent something else that's already there. Yes, yeah, so but that would be a good place to have the URL for the repository as well.
Does that sound reasonable for folks? And that makes it not GBP specific, which I think is good.
Yeah.
But that didn't tell you how to get the source for that particular version. That's my scary thought. You have an already
DEP 12?
Yeah.
Well, if the rest of the configuration is in the GBP conf file, right, then once you have the repository plus the conf file, should be able to...
No, my question is a very simple one. Where does the ORIG tag come from?
Okay, then, but that use can should know.
Yeah, the watch file should actually...
So it's not declarative, but...
Very
clear.
Really? Okay.
Isn't that in the copyright file when you first publish the...
Yes, but I think uscan is up to date because uscan kind of used to fetch the tarball, so it should be up to date.
So as long as uscan works, it's quite
okay.
Trivial. But if it doesn't work,
that's the thing.
Right? Well, and there's no policy requirement to
include
the tarball in the watch file for uscan.
Well, that's because it's really complicated sometimes, right?
Yeah, well, sometimes it's impossible. But then there are also upstreams who are their own Debian maintainer who don't bother publishing it because why would I need to scan for it when I make a release, I make a Debian release. It'd be nice to encourage those folks to include it just for the sake of everyone else. I don't know how to do that.
And you could argue that when it's complicated it's because the metadata is missing. Really.
So we only have a few minutes left. And I think this has been useful. It's been useful for me to see here what people are doing with it. Is there a way that we want to follow up further, or do we'll have questions about how to continue working with this?
I have one. I would like to have one feature. Recently, a few months ago, you added the GBP name in the comments. So when I import the fetch queue and then I export it, it has the same name. Could you add the option to ignore that completely? I prefer the previous.
Okay, yeah, I think that either there's a patch or... Yeah. Sure.
Because right now I'm sometimes changing the commit message, because I update the patch, and I export it, and then I have to fix every commit message
myself. I'm not sure if you can already do
the name.
So let me check. I will have to check, but if not, it's reasonable, yeah.
So I wanted to understand, I don't understand how to use the patch queue with the DEP 8 patch headers.
Me neither.
No, you guys are. So can you...
DEP 8 is the auto PKG?
Yeah.
So you mean DEP 3 maybe? Like,
I can't remember. There's headers that go in Debian patches files.
Yeah.
And there are custom headers that say that mention things like which bugs are closed and how the patch relates to Debian.
Yeah.
DEP 3?
Somebody would have to kind of write a parser that picks them up and preserves them. Because that's not kind of handled by GBPQ at the moment.
So yeah, kind of, like, I really like that idea, and I also really like the
GBPQ,
and so I would really like to have some kind of mix of that. Are you guys using those headers with GBPQ?
That's right, yes. We use I can say it to you.
I think in order to encourage the use of it, one could write a pre-commit hook that only applies to the patch queue branch and then pre-populate so you have some template. And this could actually encourage some kind of formatting.
But then you have
this would be optional, of course, but it might be an idea.
Then you have the problem that the commit hooks, you actually need to manually install them, right?
That's a pre-commit hook, of course. I'm not familiar with all the hooks so. But you know what I mean, just pre-populating
the pre-commit
message
to
encourage
the repo and not... If your
cloning it from another user, you don't get them.
That's what I was
saying.
Yeah,
so
but it might be a nice thing for itself.
Yeah,
I mean,
right?
Yeah, I would rely on that, or not rely, but it's handy, I would say.
Yeah, but I wouldn't. Okay, let me rephrase. I wouldn't use it.
Okay.
But if you put it in a correct message, then they will end up after the phone and those in multiple lines.
Sorry?
If you put these headers in the commit message,
yeah,
then those lines will end up after the author and phone and subject lines created by git format and whatever.
Okay, that might be challenging.
And I don't know whether that would still be that good.
But I think that's supported, isn't it?
Is it? I don't know.
I think
So this is something for that people could look into and report back to the GitHub package mailing list and say, hey, here's how you do it. That would be a really useful thing for everybody. So the three of you sound like you have a couple of ideas. Do you want to try to flesh something out that seems reasonable to the three of you and report back to the mailing list? So we've only got 1 minute. We have less than 1 minute left. So we're time up. Thanks everybody for the useful discussion.
Thanks for the talk.
Yeah.